Welcome, everybody, to this event on freedom of expression in the digital age. My name is Lyria Bennett-Moses. I'm the director of the UNSW Allens Hub for Technology, Law and Innovation. And this evening's event is in partnership with the Gilbert and Tobin Center for Public Law. We have lots of fun always doing things together on technology in public law context. So this is sort of part of a sort of long-standing collaboration between the two. I'd like to start by acknowledging that we meet those who are physically here on Bidjigal land. I would like to pay my respects to their elders past and present and acknowledge that the land was never ceded. I'd also like to welcome any Indigenous people who are here or online and encourage everybody who hasn't already to read the Uluru Statement from the Heart and to consider what we are being asked to do, particularly those of us who are Australian. The format for this panel, it's going to be sort of starting out with sort of fairly general question and giving the three panelists a chance to state, you know, broadly what their views are, and then really try to get as quickly as possible into more of a conversation, right, with the different perspectives actually talking to each other. So in that sense, we might jump around a little bit as we go. The panel will be about an hour. And for those who are live in the room, that will be followed by drinks and networking just next door. So please hang around for that. Our three panelists this evening, we have Daniel Joyce, who's an associate professor here in the Faculty of Law and Justice, specialising in international law, media law and human rights. We have Siddharth Narain, who has recently submitted his PhD. So exactly. Maybe Siddharth, you can share with us the exact title that as submitted.
It's called Facebook's Crowds and Publics, Law, Virality, and the Regulation of Hate Speech Online in Contemporary India.
Fantastic. So very relevant. And we're going to come back to look at some of the issues in India along the way in the conversation. And last but not least, Surya Balendra, who is visiting us as an LLM candidate at McGill University in Canada, but is originally from Sri Lanka, where he is also studied and as was a lecturer as well, teaching in a university there. So please, everybody, welcome our panel. Okay, so starting question. Headline, should we regulate online speech? If so, what kind and why? Who wants to kick us off? Daniel?
Shall I do that? Yeah, look, obviously these are really critical questions for us to be thinking about. But even the kind of framing of that question can give us a sense that there's lots of different perspectives, there's lots of different ways that we might seek to do that. And also perhaps that our traditional conceptions of regulation and how we should go about positioning the law in relation to speech are also challenged by contemporary developments, developing media forms, and also, changing conceptions as some of the kind of promotional material for this event alluded to in terms of speech and forms of speech. So ChatGPT, is our latest kind of anxiety-inducing kind of case study, but there's been obviously earlier issues and concerns around kind of, you know, emerging forms of computational propaganda, what to do about misinformation, disinformation, and so on. In terms of should we regulate online speech? If so, what kind and why? I mean, I think we should. I think that we do in any event. I mean, often if we approach these questions with a free speech lens, and often we have, that is, we are regulating still, but we are regulating in more of a protective, facilitative form. And I guess what some of the developments that we're concerned about here are pointing to is whether we need a bit more of a heavy-handed approach, a bit more of a punitive approach. Does that involve criminalization? Does it involve new forms of regulation? I've been quite interested in questions around kind of jurisdiction as well. So I sort of been unusual in the sense that I've approached these questions sort of from kind of on high down. But then I've been interested in the international legal responses. And often that's an area where you see absence as well, or rather patchy kind of sets of frameworks or aspirational frameworks which seek to balance and to some degree seek some form of harmony, right? Like in a normative sense, but often don't actually, or at least the criticism is, they often don't necessarily offer a pragmatic form of more fully fledged regulatory purchase in these contexts. So I guess I think that my influence is obviously human rights law. So in terms of how they should be regulated, what principles we might look to, I do think that we do have a kind of international legal framework, international human rights law. It has its problems. It has its kind of particular focuses. It can tend to individuate these issues. It can tend to underplay the role of private actors, tends to sort of emphasize the state. And even though we can see that there's an ongoing anxiety around state intervention and a concern with kind of, you know, forms of state-driven censorship and so on, in using kind of a progressive form of regulation, perhaps, as justification, I do think that we need to think a lot more at the moment about private actors and private power and how they are shaping our kind of speech cultures and increasingly, like Siddhartha's been investigating in the case of Facebook, you know, they're actually kind of potentially, you know, equally significant in regulatory terms. So it's hard as an international law sort of person to kind of propose forms of regulation in some ways, because obviously people have expectations of international law that sometimes it doesn't really set out to achieve. So I think international lawyers are interested in more experimental forms of governance at the moment, engaging private actors, soft law, as well as kind of, you know, taking seriously the jurisprudence that emerges from you know, the Human Rights Committee and their general comments, the special rapporteurs and those kinds of aspects. But obviously all of this kind of work can't just be done at the international level and traditionally has been done mainly at the state and the regional level anyway. So I guess that's my kind of initial take.
And you pointed to Siddhartha's work there in the context of the private power. Siddhartha, do you want to take that up?
Yeah, sure. So what's interesting is when we think about regulation of platforms, it's often the most visible forms of regulation is regulation by state authorities. And really most of my project examines regulation by a private platform like Facebook through its internal rules and guidelines. And while from the outside it might appear there's very little actually happening because there's so much criticism of the platform, but relatively speaking, if you look at a platform like Facebook as compared to other ones, it's actually quite sophisticated and advanced when compared to other platforms. A huge investment in governance mechanisms involving all kinds of a constellation of actors, highly sophisticated automated technologies, and all of this is already happening. It's already happening and has been happening for a while. So the question would be more, how much, you know, the questions like transparency over what they're doing, and also, of course, what the impact of this is and how much they should be doing. And I think what's also interesting is when you think about what a platform like Facebook is doing, it's not just taking off content, it regulates in a variety of ways, right? Like they might label things, there are warnings. Increasingly, they do something called content reduction, which is basically they make sure through the algorithmic, you know, what they use, that you're not seeing certain kinds of content without actually taking it off, or the chances of visibility, they reduce visibility. So there's a lot of this that's already happening. And I think what's interesting is how this then interacts with local laws and jurisdictions that I look at, for instance, Global South jurisdictions like India, where there is increasing pressure on the platform to act, but often to act selectively about certain content, and then there's a bit of a pushback, and then and how that operates and how that plays out.
So overall, you think, just in terms of where people are sort of coming down, you'd say yes to regulation?
Yeah, I think given that this is something, I mean, let me put it this way. I began the project with a much more perspective, which is much more free speech oriented, much more concerned about the impact of such regulation. But at the end of the journey, I think, yes, more or less, I would say that there is and there should be. But the question is the nuances of how the best way, the best possible path.
I think it's always a sign of an excellent PhD thesis when you convince yourself and change your own mind through the course of the research.
Exactly.
So. Surya.
So my perspective will be like, so sometimes the professor and Sid was answering tactically sometimes whether we have to go through a regulation or not. But on that aspect, I will be something bold. So I can clearly make a statement that we need regulations for the social media, especially the online content.
Louder, just for the back.
Oh, sorry. So I will be something bold. I will be saying like we need regulations for the social media, especially for the online content. The reason is simply the social media is an amplification of the democracy in the digital space. So when we are having number of rights and limitations of those rights in the physical space or in-person space, those rights and limitations should be adapted in the online space as well. So we can appreciate the democracy has attained a different level with the introduction of the social media. At the same time, the digital democracy and free speech in the online aspect, but at the same time, we have to agree there's an other side and in the reflective side of this free speech unlimitedly. For an example, we can point out manipulation, extremism, hate speech, and xenophobia. Like that, we have number of issues over the social media aspects as well. So therefore, on one hand, we need regulation for sure, but the question will be how we are going to regulate the social media or online content. Who will be the appropriate parties or appropriate authorities to regulate this online content as well? So Sid has pointed out the internal regulations of the Facebook and its relativism, but I would like to cover some areas around the external regulations over these technology actors. So I would say from my studies, if we are going to delegate some kind of powers for a state authority, for an example, for a state authority or executive authority to regulate this online content and those aspects, that may lead to the authoritarian approach in the digital space. That clearly include internet shutdowns, surveillance, disinformation, hate speeches, and targeted arrest and number of issues all over there. So therefore, I would like to comment on that point, how we are going to regulate this online content. We don't need the state actors and executive and administrative level authorities to deal case by cases. But what they can do is they can have a control over this technology platforms. For an example, they can introduce content moderation laws. Or we can say they can introduce similar principles like Section 230 of Community Decency Act of US. By these kind of arrangements, what they can do is they can have a close watch over the social media institutions, but these social media companies and technologies platforms can have a deal with individuals and individual posts and comments on the cyberspace. For example, so in Myanmar coup in 2021 and Iran, what was happened was during the protest time, the freedom of assembly is a constitutional right and as well as democratic value in a physical space. What the government has done was they have shut down the internet access. By way of this shutdown of internet access, they have clearly limited and clearly infringed the people's right in a democratic space. Then in the second issue, I would like to point out the internet shutdowns during the electoral periods. So election period, it can be state election or parliamentary election. The floating of the information will be the key factor in deciding the votes. So during that aspect, what the states have attempted to do is they have clearly take the control over the internet platforms. For an example, in Uganda in 2021, as well as in Nigeria, these incidents were happened. So these incidents are clearly a digital authoritarian approach by the state actors over the democratic value in the human right values in the physical space as well as in the online space. Therefore, we should consider we can regulate the internet space for sure. But here the question, how we are going to regulate and who can regulate, especially addressing the democratic and human rights and free speech values in the cyberspace. I would like to point out the Me Too movement. The Me Too movement is one of the wonderful movements that spread all over the world. But even the Me Too movement, there was a case was filed in China, Chinese tennis star Peng Shuai. So she was a tennis woman, but her Me Too movement was cracked down by the Chinese blanket censorship models. The reason is what the tennis star alleged against Communist Party leader. So because of these all intervention, it can be Black Lives Matter protests, it can be Me Too movements. The internet has become a key role in amplifying the digital democracy in the modern aspect. But this state authoritarian approach would lead to harm those values, to pull down those values to none. So a quick 2 points. So I would like to say that technologies agents will be the best actors in regulating this online content. Two reasons. One, the technology institutions are the best in dealing with the issues all around the technology space. For example, if you are an administrative body, if you are an executive body, still we want to cooperate with the technology agencies to overcome the issues in related to the harm speech or fake speech in the online. For an example, it can be related to the automation. It can be related to the algorithm. It can be related to the community standards prescribed by those agents. Second thing, the administrative level and executive level, if we are going to give utmost power or utmost authority to deal with these issues, it will lead to authoritarian approach. Simply, for an example, I can say in US, what's happening, the most of the cases are dealt by the judiciary, not by the executive or administrative level, especially when related to the free speech in the online speech. But in a global South market or in every country, we can't deal every cases with the judicial helps. So we have to take down something in advance within a quicker time limitations. So for these cases, what we can suggest is the governments and state authorities can deal with the technologies. At the same time, the technologies can have a control over the users and its opinion that spread all over the cyberspace. Thank you.
Yeah, so one way of thinking about it is, you know, if you're dealing with, you know, the physical world, right, and you're dealing with, I don't know, movie cinemas and what gets shown in movie cinemas, it's very easy for the government to do it all the way down, right? Like they say, we have a rating system, you know, there's community panels. This is Australia, but, you know, there's community panels, you know, you show them the movie, they go, this is R, that one's G, et cetera. Once we're dealing with online content and social media, which is a much faster process than of any kind of control, right, you have to, in a sense, I mean, there's not really an option for government to be directly making decisions about everything. You have to have partial automation and a kind of alert-based responsive system, at which point it has to be run at that tech level. Would that, and so that, I know you've looked at this in your thesis, the combination of what Facebook does and the regulation in India, would that be a fair summary of that relationship?
Yeah, I think so, because just the sheer scale and speed with which the content that they're dealing with, it's literally millions of pieces of content. And to expect, judicial overview of this scale is just not practically feasible. And even with their sophisticated technologies that they're using, it there's so much of content that slips through that, even now, because it's simply if you take a subset of harmful content, hate speech specifically, it's still not possible to completely do it automated, because you need somebody, a human sitting there who will then look at the context. I'd agree with that. I just to say that Surya is right that in contexts such as maybe Sri Lanka, but even India and other in the US that he pointed to, there's this constant tension between this fear that there are going to be authoritarian populist regimes are going to use this against for their own ends, and at the same time we see it already being used. It's already being used by not official state authorities, but by collective forms, mobs, crowds, what I call crowds at publics, who are anyway using this form very effectively to basically subordinate minorities, create tensions. I was just constantly keeping it on the boil for various reasons, and India is a classic example. So it's not as if there's that side to it as well. So you already have this playing out at a constant level. You don't need extreme crackdown for a serious situation. You already have this happening at levels and it erupts. So you know, it's a complex situation. So how do you then address this? And who are those actors who are going to address this?
Yeah, and I mean, in a sense, a lot of the companies are, if not global, then broad in terms of the jurisdiction. I say not global because often, say, in China, there'll be separate social media companies to the ones that we might use, you know, in Australia. But maybe we can think about that, you know, that challenge, right? You've got the different national governments with various agendas, good and bad. And then you've got the sort of tech companies that sort of cut across those. And we can sort of say, well, how effective, like how good is it? How right have we got it, say in Australia? Daniel?
Yeah, so look, I think I was thinking a lot about what Saria and Siddharth were saying, particularly your point, Saria, about you know, social media and how it connects to the democratic kind of questions. Because obviously in the Australian context, a lot of these questions around regulation of speech and how to balance, you know, harmful regulation of harmful speech or prescribe harmful speech, but then also try to kind of keep a free society and so on, all connects back with our kind of conception of, you know, what our democracy is. And so the Australian context is a bit patchy though, right? So we have a bit of a messy picture, I would say. We don't have a Bill of Rights, as many will know. We have an implied freedom of political communication, which is not a freestanding right, but obviously draws on sort of broader kind of free speech, constitutional sort of ideas there. We have vilification laws as well. So they manifest in different ways, though. So we have a Commonwealth set of vilification laws that really are concerned with mainly racial vilification, but have standards that are perceived to be lower in terms of their threshold than states and territories. The states and territories deal with a range of different forms of harmful vilification in terms of, you know, vilification of particular groups and religious vilification and so on, but it's not a uniform context. So it's quite a confusing kind of mix. And often there's a sense that because we don't have a Bill of Rights and some kind of more positive form of protection for speech, often the speech debates occur at the sort of limit cases of these various conceptual areas like vilification laws and so on. So, you know, there was a lot of controversy around the Bolt case, for example, and that became a kind of platform for debating the state of free speech in a way, whether there was a right to, you know, speak harmfully, to insult and so on, which itself became quite harmful in terms of its broader social impacts. It's interesting though now, so we also have defamation law does a lot of the work, right? So this connects quite nicely as well with what you were saying about Section 230 and safe harbours and so on, because one of the things I think that's interesting about these social media companies is until quite recently, and until the term that Siddharth is investigating in his work, they didn't really consider themselves to be publishers, right? So when I've sort of tended to approach these questions from a media law perspective, you have this sort of fairly, maybe a bit clunky, maybe a bit dubious now in terms of loss of trust in the media, but this conception that the media, for good or ill, were performing a kind of democratic watchdog function, right? And it hasn't always been clear that these new speech actors, if you like, consider themselves in those ways until, I guess, more recently, the scale of the kind of issues relating to their activities that you've both talked about has meant that they've actually had to look to human rights principles and perhaps consider themselves as publishers with responsibilities in that regard. But it's interesting too, because they are global companies. So do they owe, to whom is their audience, and to whom do they owe these kinds of responsibilities? It's quite a tricky thing. Just very quickly, in terms of the Australian context, we've got defamation law, but that's individual private cause of action. It does a lot of work. So people have used defamation law or considered that defamation law should be stretched to kind of try to deal with sort of misinformation, online misogyny, a range of different areas, but it's not always the right kind of tool. Counterterrorism laws as well. There's a lot of the responses the Gilbert and Tobin Centre has so ably shown has been with kind of like sort of hyper legislative sort of responses to the kind of national security dimension, Interestingly now, though, there has been a turn in recent years, I think since 2021 and so on, towards more kind of consideration of notions of like online safety and so on, trying to bring together some of the regulators. So there's like an e-safety commissioner, the ACCC and its own digital platforms inquiry. It's obviously the competition regulator. It's positioned itself as potentially having a bit more clout than some of the other less well-funded, less kind of perhaps successful in terms of their sort of remit regulators. But I think it's just over the weekend. I mean, I've just been printing stuff off the internet before our discussion here. The communications minister, Michelle Rowland, has kind of foreshadowed some new misinformation, disinformation regulations that might come in. And from what I've been able to tell, they're quite interesting because they position ACMA as a sort of like our communications and media regulator, which, you know, has had, I think, a fairly patchy run. It's obviously done some really good things, but it's not necessarily been perceived as the most powerful regulator in terms of its ability to constrain at least media actors. But it's now being positioned as a regulator that, if it can't sort of get the main platforms and players to agree to kind of their own sort of stronger form of self-regulation, could potentially impose a kind of its own code. So I think that tends to be, that's quite a sophisticated approach, actually, sort of dealing with some of the issues here that have emerged. So it can't just be the state because, again, I think the minister, interestingly, is kind of doesn't want to be seen as a state censor. So they're sort of in the communications saying, well, look, we're not talking about the government intervening to take stuff down from, we'd rather you guys did this. But if you don't do it, then we might have to kind of, you know, get further involved. And in terms of penalties, they're now talking about, and I think in the privacy context, they've been doing this as well, and the Information Commission has got increased powers and so on, but kind of talking about percentages of revenue as well as ways of kind of focusing the attention of some of these digital platforms. So I guess the short message is there's lots happening. It can be quite hard to connect these different areas conceptually, and without a kind of central kind of constitutional form of protection for speech, often critics of what's happening, critics of regulation, sort of look at everything that's happening as a kind of as damaging speech, right, and as kind of overreach by government. But in a way, I think you could think, well, okay, that, you know, perhaps it is ironic that we tend to have more regulation that is dealing with harmful speech rather than more that is positively protecting free speech. But I think we probably need both things. I think we probably do need Bill of Rights reform alongside sort of more targeted regulation, you know, looking at things like child pornography, online harms, all those things that we all look, you know, are particularly concerned about in these new environments. Thank you.
Thanks. So Australia usually does not make international news for its regulation. No. Probably more the US and EU, very different jurisdictions. And Suri, I know you've been looking at those. How do you think they've gone?
Right. So when it comes to the US, I would say so they are primarily handling the issues through the judiciary almost with the major cases. At the same time, they have this Section 230 of Community Decency Act, safe harbor principles are there. At the same time, they have tried to figure out some new legislations. For example, Safe Tech Act, they were trying since 2021 to be passed, but unfortunately, it's not enforced yet. At the same time, Revised PACT Act, also Justice Against Malicious Algorithms Act, JAMA. So these are the three different legislative attempts they have done by the US, but still they are working around Section 230 of CDA. At the same time, they are dealing the issues with the judiciary. For an example, there are a couple of cases, are ongoing cases, the Twitter versus Tamene case and Journalists versus Google. So these are the two cases. I hope by 2023 we can get the judgment for these two cases. So these judgments may make a huge impact in these free speech regulations all around the world, I quite believe. But at the same time, when it's come to the US, I would say after the First Amendment, the rights, from the free speech perspective and the rights perspective, the US are clearly stressed down these kind of regulations. For an example, so in my point of view, whenever US is trying to create new laws, especially regulating this online content, protests and online free speech, they are quite worried about their democratic and free speech in the online space. So that's the reason they are always getting some delayed, and sometimes they are aborting their plan to get rid of new legislation. But when we are discussing about European Union, so when it's come to the European Union, I would say the social media issue is a global issue. So European Union is a part of the globe, but still the standards adapted by the EU cannot be applied to each and every state around the world. For an example, the Global South, I am not sure about the relevancy of the standards adapted by the EU. But the EU is going through a new amendment to this framework. For an example, Digital Service Act, DSA, is coming to force very soon. At the same time, some of the provisions have already came into force by November 2022. At the same time, the DSA is pretty clear how this free speech and the online illegal content can be regulated. So on that point, I can get some kind of abstract view from their European Union perspective. On one hand, they are clear about how we are going to regulate this online content to some extent. For an example, they are giving some kind of safe harbor principles to the internet intermediaries. For an example, tech giants, and at the same time, it can be like internet intermediaries such as broadcasting corporations and everything. At the same time, they are very clear about on which instances they have to be responsible, which are the obligations we can give to these internet intermediaries. Another good aspect of DSA is really clear how we can cooperate together. So with the technology intermediaries, with the state authorities, at the same time, European Union all together, how we can work together when we are going to deal with this kind of illegal contents and free speech issues in the online. Moreover, they are really clear they have to audit the technology platforms that have 45 million active monthly users should be governed by this DSA. At the same time, they have to prepare a monthly report to the European Union by way of auditing their issues and their responses to those issues. I believe the standard adopted by the European Union can sometimes vary from the Global South market, but still the techniques, still the abstract views proposed by the DSA is one intermediary should have some safe harbor principle. At the same time, they should have some kind of obligations on these issues. They cannot simply leave this is the user's issues, not ours. The reason you are giving a platform and you should maintain some kind of basic obligations to these issues. Second, the auditing and the overall cooperative work together with the technology and as well as administrative executive overlook would be a good side of DSA, I believe. Thank you.
Fantastic. And speaking of Global South, which was mentioned briefly there by way of comparison, Siddharth, what about India?
So I think there's the basic point would be that all of what Surya mentioned, especially what's happening in Europe, I would look at them as almost best practices that the Indian model could follow. And the Indian government is in fact right now busy redesigning a lot of the basic law, the IT Act, which governs most of this is being redesigned. And purportedly looking at these best practices to do so. But the problem is in the question of translation. When you translate it into a context such as India today, there's not much trust that it's actually going to lead to creeping and more government control. And you know, recently, they've gone through a series of revisions in the last six months, one year, it's difficult to keep track of because there's so much happening in that space. But one of the things they're very, very interested in and which came to the news because of this potential clash of the platforms is that they want platforms to have grievance redressal officers. So basically they want the position they're coming from is that you're global platforms and you have to be subject to Indian law. That's the basic position. And of course the technology has changed and we need to adapt to standards. And the way that they do it is we cannot exercise control over y'all if you don't have a physical presence there. When you have a physical presence there, then we want this grievance redressal officer in the country. And one of the ways we'll ensure that you comply is we will send police to your offices, to the Twitter offices. So when there were these farmers' protests, widespread farmers' protests that were happening in India. Greta Thunberg tweeted about it, and it became an embarrassment for the government, and you know there was a lot of attention. And one of the responses was basically to send police to the Twitter offices as a kind of warning. So if that is the approach, then you know whatever the best practices may be, and theoretically that we do want them to do this, and it needs regulation. I agree completely, but how does that translate into a context where it's, you know, a country which has slipped dramatically in all the official indices related to democracy, basically being labeled as an ethnic democracy because of populist majoritarian and authoritarian politics? And what does that mean for spaces of dissent? What does it mean for minorities specifically in the country? There's a serious ramifications for any such change. And I think it's a contrast to Australia as well, because yes, you could have an e-safety commissioner here who's relatively independent and politicians are willing to say, okay, you take it. But what does that mean in the Indian context? It's not possible to think of that kind of independent authority now. I would say today it's very difficult to think about a relatively independent institution that could actually carry this out. And as much as the language of law and constitutionalism is used, I think at the heart of it, there are these very, very deep concerns. So that's the translation in the Global South context. I'm sure there are many other contexts. It's not like that India is some unique example, but it's definitely an important example because India has the largest number of users on many platforms, including Facebook and Instagram and WhatsApp. India is a growing market. Countries like India, I would say, in Global South are growing markets. And there has been a closed relationship and a reluctance of these platforms to actually act on issues like hate speech in the Indian context, because they are worried not just about their profitability and future growth in the country, but also actually now about the safety of their employees. Facebook has 300 employees, over 20 offices in India, and they're worried that there could be even a backlash against their own employees. So it's a very loaded question that translates in very complex ways.
And I think, you know, the sort of what these different jurisdictions are trying to do is often quite different. So if you compare something like, you know, Europe's Digital Service Act and what they're trying to achieve through that with say, you know, whether real or perceived, you know, the perceptions of what might be happening in India, that seems, would you say that's quite different in terms of the government's goal?
Yeah, the government's goal, it is different. And the thing is, all this has happened recently. If you'd asked me this question even 8 years ago, I might have had a slightly, like, these concerns were not so acute 8 years ago. And, you know, I wouldn't be thinking, who's listening to this recording? Who's listening to this seminar? Like, where could it circulate? That's never a concern. And now it is a concern. And that tells you something.
Interesting. Okay, so we're going to open it up to questions.